we are identified with him. Christ is in me, I'm in Christ. So when Jesus died, I died. When Jesus rose, I rose. When Jesus ascended, I ascended. When Jesus has and he does victory over sin, I do too. Over the demons, I do too. Over the devil, I do too. Do you understand who you are? Lisa and I were in New York City this past summer. We walked out of our hotel and an employee handed us, well, really he handed it to me, an umbrella. He said, "You're going to need this because the weather doesn't look very good. So just use it." I said, "Okay." I'm not a big umbrella-toting guy. Thankfully, though, I had the umbrella. Thankfully, when it started raining, I actually just opened the umbrella, and that was it. Let me see if I can do it. Yeah, here we go. Yeah, open the umbrella. And I was able to protect us from the elements. Now, it would have been pretty sad if it had been raining and I had just kept the umbrella like this, wouldn't it? I mean, I would have been a complete and total idiot to walk the streets of New York being pounded by the elements with an umbrella like this. So instead of like this, I had the umbrella like this. Again, I'm not a big umbrella guy, but I've been doing some research on the umbrella. The umbrella is one of the most left items, TSA tells us, on public transportation. It's like, the umbrella is number one, then the phone, then keys, then wallets, if you were just wondering about that. There are different names for the umbrellas that I have discovered. Some umbrellas are called parasols. That's another name for them. Another name is a sunshade. Yet another name is a brolly. Another name is a bumper chute. Yet another name is a protectorship. And that's where we're going today. We're going to look at this umbrella as a means of protection, as a means of a veil, means of shielding us from the elements, or you could say the helements. The umbrella. Do you use the umbrella? Okay. I think you do now and then. But how about in a deeper sense? How about not just walking the streets in inclement weather, but how about in life? Are you using the umbrella in life? Because when I was a kid, my father used to talk about authority now and then, and he would use an umbrella as an illustration. He would simply say, "You know, we need to get under the umbrella of authority." It's a pretty good word picture, isn't it? And he went on to explain to me that God is a God of authority. This is my father, and we need to get under the authority of God. When we get under the authority of God, then God will show us what should be under us. But until we get under the authority of God, we'll never know what should be beneath us. When I say the word authority, I know what you think. Oh my goodness, what a depressing word, authority. Rules, curfews, limitations, laws, taxes. I don't like the word, Ed. And hey, I totally understand. But authority in God's economy is an awesome word. It's a great word. It's a wonderful word. A word that is key to you and to me. Authority. Do you have authority issues? As we look around our world today, a lot of people have authority issues. Our first authority figure that we ever really noticed externally were our parents. And what a lot of us do is, throughout the journey of life, we project that authority vibe we had with our parents onto every other authority. And if you look back in recent history, think about the 1960s. Think about the anti-authority mentality that's been perpetuated in education, entertainment, and in pretty much every sphere of life. Today, it's cool, it's hip to be a rebel, to be anti-authority. Then we have neo-Marxism, we have this wokeism that simply critiques hierarchy, yet they want to become the authority. They don't like authority, yet they want to rule and to reign. So it's a paradoxical, twisted, satanic situation. Authority. Authority is a good word. I follow a guy on my Instagram feed, and he teaches people how to speak, because I'm always trying to improve how I speak. And one of the things he said, when you smile and you talk, things are received oftentimes in a better light. Just try it. Just try it with me right now. I want you to say, with the smile on your face, authority. 1, 2, 3, authority. 1, 2, 3, authority. 1, 2, 3, authority. Man, I feel so positive. I feel so happy. That's how we should look at authority. So authority is not negative. Hey, kids, it's not negative. Single adults, it's not negative. Young marriage is not negative. Those of us who are older, it's not negative. It's a positive thing. I'm not talking, though, about power in this series. We're going to talk about this for a while. I'm not talking about power. Power is innate. Power is something I grab. Authority is given. Authority always comes from above. March Madness is here, correct? You'll see all these amazingly talented athletes, massive guys, powerful guys, go up and down the hardwood shooting threes and playing defense, and you're like, whoa, these guys are powerful, man. They don't, though, have the most power on the court. Do you know who has the most authority on the court? The little wimpy guys in tight black polyester pants with striped shirts going. The referees. That was a pretty good imitation, wasn't it? The refs have authority because the authority has been given to them by the NCAA. As a believer, I have amazing authority because it's been given to me by the God of the universe. So I'm afraid most people, I'm talking to myself, we don't really realize who we are. We don't realize the authority that we've been given. So in today's opening remarks, I'm going to talk to you today about authority and the power that should surprise us. I'm going to describe to you the power that comes from the authority of God. Next week is going to get really fun. I'm going to talk about the authority figures that God has placed in all of our lives. God has placed authority figures in every person's life, and these authority figures have, here's the key word, jurisdiction in certain situations and spaces and places in all of our lives. Here's what I'm talking about. As a father, you have a certain amount of jurisdiction. As a boss, you have a certain amount of jurisdiction. As a Christian, we have jurisdiction. A coach, a teacher, the government, I could go on and on. We're going to talk next week about how do we deal with that. And moreover, how do you deal with that jerk at work who's in authority over you? How do you deal with people who abuse authority? That's next week. And then Easter, we're talking about the ultimate power of authority and how to leverage it where we live. And it obviously comes through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So that's where we're going over the next several weeks. But this authority issue is like the issue, the foundation when it comes to the nature and the character of God and who God wants you and me to be. Because we identify with Christ. Those of us who are believers, we have identity in Him. I'm sure you have a passport. That's your identity. I'm sure you have a driver's license. That's your identity. We show our driver's license. We show our passport. That's our identity. That's who we are. In Christ, and I'm going to talk about this, think about this, we are identified with Him. Christ is in me, I'm in Christ. So when Jesus died, I died. When Jesus rose, I rose. When Jesus ascended, I ascended. When Jesus has and He does victory over sin, I do too. Over the demons, I do too. Over the devil, I do too. Do you understand who you are? I mean, if I was truthful, I sometimes forget who I am. One day, Jesus was in a town called Capernaum, and a centurion sent some of his people to Jesus. It was kind of like an ancient text situation. And these representatives from the centurion said, hey, the centurion wanted me to give you a message, Jesus, that one of his servants is sick on his deathbed, and if you'll just give the word, he will be healed. So Jesus healed him at a distance. He told, you know, the centurion's people, hey, everything's cool. This is my paraphrase. This guy is going to be healed. And in Luke chapter 7, verses 7 through 8, this centurion, through his representatives, talks to Jesus about, you're not going to believe this, authority. So one minute he's talking about, Jesus, will you heal my servant? Then he pivots. Isn't that a big word in today's culture? Let me pivot. He pivots and he starts talking about authority. The Bible says this in Luke chapter 7, verses 7 through 8. For that reason, we pick up in the middle of the conversation, I did not even consider myself worthy to come to you, this is a centurion, but just say the word and my servant shall be healed. I mean, that's some serious faith, isn't it? For I also am a man placed under authority. So the key phrase, the key word is for I also. The key word is also. Say also with me, also. Also am a man placed under authority. In other words, he's saying, I'm under authority as a centurion. I have the governor over me, the emperor over me, and Jesus, you're under authority too. It's interesting. For I'm also a man placed under authority with soldiers under myself, and I say to this one, go, and he goes. To another, come, and he comes, and to my slave, do this, and he does it. Authority. What does authority mean? Authority is, you can write this down, an official legal right to rule. It's an official, let me emphasize this word, legal right to rule. It's an authorization to make decisions within the particular, I've already said the word earlier, jurisdiction. That's what authority is. And the Bible says that Jesus, I don't have time to read the entire story, marveled at this centurion's faith. Only twice did Jesus marvel, and this is one of the times. So when Jesus marvels at something, we better go, well, we better focus in on why. Why? Well, the centurion was like, okay, I can give the word and people do stuff. Jesus, you can give the word and someone can be healed. Jesus, I'm under authority, and because I'm under authority, I have over 100 people reporting to me. And Jesus, you're under authority as well. Now, stay with me for a second. Jesus voluntarily was under the authority while on earth of his Father and the Holy Spirit and the Word of God. We need to understand the origin of authority. The origin of authority. The origin is God. It comes from God. God is the author of authority. It's in the name of God. The Bible says in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, you'll see it on the screens, let us, that's the word Elohim, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, let us make man in our image. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, 3 in 1, 1 in 3. Within the Trinity, the name of God, you have voluntarily, the Godhead voluntarily submitting to one another. And also, we know that they are equal in form, unique in function. They're the same, but you have authority within that. When Jesus was on planet Earth, he was under the authority of his parents. He was under the authority of laws. He was under the authority, again, of the Father, of the Holy Spirit, of the Word of God. Jesus was fully God and fully man, something we'll never totally understand. He lived not as God on earth, but as man on earth, yet he was still fully God. The origin of authority. God thought it up. It was his idea. So it's in his name, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, authority. It's also in his nature. As we understand the isness of God, as I've said before, as wet is to water, as heat is to fire, authority is to God. He is the authority, the creator, the maker, the sustainer of everything. The origin, that's God. Authority always comes from above. That centurion knew it came from above, and because he got under what was over him, God allowed him, the centurion, to rule and to lead those people who were beneath him. And he wants to do the same thing in your life. Yet too many of us live life without ever knowing what should be beneath us. And that brings us to the second aspect of authority. Just some introductory words today. The origin is God. The object, you ready for this? That's you and me, mankind. We're the object of God's authority. God made us for authority. The Bible says in Genesis chapter 1, verse 28, then God blessed them, talking about Adam and Eve, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. Have, say it with me. Let's smile when we say that. Have dominion. Okay, because it's a good word. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. The word dominion means to tread upon. God gave Adam and Eve authority. He gave them dominion. And one of the authoritative things they were able to do was, God says, name all of the creatures on planet Earth. Hey, moms and dads, especially young moms and dads, don't we love to name our kids? We go online, check out certain websites, go on Pinterest, read books. All these unique names in today's culture. You know, when the twins were born, I wanted to name them Monique and Unique, but Lisa said, no, I can't believe it. But I love these creative names. I really, really do. We're the object of God's authority. God made us to have dominion. He made us to have authority. It's a legal right to act. That's why I'm here. But you know what happened? Adam squandered it. He fumbled it. He messed up. And we have been dealing with that for a long, long time. To give you the cliff notes, what Adam did was, when he sinned, he literally dethroned God and enthroned himself, which meant he enthroned Satan. And the Bible says, whoever we're enslaved to, we are their slave. So literally, he became a slave to Satan, and his offspring have that issue as well. It's pretty heavy, isn't it? So you have the origin of authority, that's God. You have the object of authority, that's man. Adam legally, remember, because authority is a legal term, legally lost it. Legally. Now you might be going, well, why didn't God just snatch it back? Come on. I mean, how easy is that? Because God is not going to make a farce of his justice. It has to righteously, I'm talking about authority, it has to righteously be regained by a man. But the man, stay with me now, cannot or could not be a slave or a son of Adam. Okay, what did God do? That's why the virgin birth is so huge. Are you with me? Conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of a woman, you have Jesus, the God-man. Jesus dying on a rugged cross for our sin, obviously living perfectly, then rising again. So Jesus righteously regained the authority that Adam had squandered. Does that make sense? What an ingenious plan of God. So God did that not because he needs authority. He is authority. He did that for you and me. I ask myself, Ed, why sometimes do you live such a defeated life? You don't realize your ID. You've not read your passport. You've not looked at your driver's license. I mean, when he died, I died. When he rose, I rose. When he ascended, I ascended. And he has victory, Jesus does, over sin and the demons and the devil, and so do I. Not perfectly. That won't happen until the millennium, of course. But we have something called kingdom authority. The origin of authority, okay. The object of authority, all right. The opposition of authority, we know who that is. That's the enemy. That's the devil. Why does the devil come after authority? Well, that's an easy answer. Think about the heavenlies. He was the worship leader in heaven. Lucifer, he tried to usurp God. He tried to dethrone God and enthrone himself. It didn't work. He was kicked out. He took a third of the angels with him. They're now the demons. So he is trying to get done on earth what he didn't get done in heaven. That's why he went after Adam and Eve the way he did. But Jesus righteously regained it. That's why he's after your authority and mine. That's why he doesn't want us to understand who we are. That's why he loves when people abuse authority or misuse authority. He doesn't want us to know who we are. And then we have the octane, of course, the octane of authority. That's the power. The word authority in Luke chapter 10 is pronounced exousia. Exousia is mentioned over 102 times in Scripture. And the Bible tells you and me in Luke chapter 10, I believe it's verse 19, I've given you authority, exousia, over all the power of the enemy. The Emancipation Proclamation. January 1, 1863, set forth by President Abraham Lincoln. When it came down the pike, a lot of slaves in the South hadn't heard the news. And if you know their history, they still worked on the plantations, worked for their masters. Some slaves heard about it, but they were like, oh, this is too good to be true. But then one day, they all discovered, praise the Lord, freedom. It could be in your life and mine that we're the same. We've been set free. We have this authority. This freedom of choice, we've been empowered. We have this responsibility to leverage authority. And some of us have never even understood that. We've never heard it. And then others are like, oh, Ed, this is too good to be true. You got to be lying to me. No, I'm not. It's from the Word of God. Our origin of authority is God. And the opposition is the devil. And the octane is the power of the Holy Spirit of God. Get under those things God has put over you. It starts with God, because God has your best interest in mind. And then you'll understand what it means to be over those things that God has placed beneath you. It's all about the umbrella. Let's bow our heads. Father, thank you for this message. Thank you for your truth and your word. And it's my earnest prayer, if you're here and you've never, ever asked Jesus Christ to be Lord of your life, to move under his authority, that you would make and take this step. Just simply say, God, you're my authority. You're my Lord. I turn from my sin and turn to you, Lord. Many of you need to say that. Others here, maybe for the first time, you just realized, wow, I have authority I didn't know I had. Authority over that sin. Authority over the enemy. I have authority. And God, I want to walk in it. Others here, maybe you've forgotten it or you've not really applied it. God, go with us over the next several weeks as we take this journey beneath your umbrella of authority. In Christ's name we pray, amen.
Hi guys, thank you so much for watching the Ed Young YouTube channel.
That's right, and if you want to be inspired, encouraged, and challenged like never before, subscribe and click the notification button.
We believe this channel can help change your life.